Hi, welcome to a new video tutorial on the structure of plant cell. We know that cell is the structural and functional unit of all living organism except some organism like virus and viroids. They are not made up of cell. They are made up of genetic material and protein or RNA, something like the rolling. In this video class, here we are going to study the structure of plant cell, and we know that plant cell consisting of mainly two part. One is called the cell wall and second one is called protoplasm. When you look at the structure of plant cell, you can see an outermost layer. That outermost layer is called the cell wall. And inner to that cell wall, you can see a membrane. You can see another layer or a membrane. That membrane is called a cell membrane. Within that cell membrane, you can see a large balloon-like empty airspace. That is called vacuole. That vacuole occupy more than 70% of the total space. That is the main feature of plant cell. And you can see the controlling unit of cell, that is called a nucleus, and a fluid filled region. That fluid filled region is called cytoplasm. Within that cytoplasm, we can see lot of cell organelles like chloroplast, mitochondria, endoplasm, reticulum, Golgi bodies. All these part, excluding the cell wall, are collectively called the protoplasm. So protoplasm is the part of plant which include nucleus, cytoplasm, vacuole, cell membrane. Every part, all part of plant except the cell wall are collectively called the protoplasm. And when we try to study the detailed structure of cell wall, we can say that cell wall is the outermost layer and they act as a protective layer. And one more thing is that they help for providing proper shape to the cell. Because we know that without cell wall, the cell will never exist in a proper stable shape. So the cell wall gives proper shape to the cell by act as a wall around the protoplasm. And when we take the chemical composition of plant cell wall, especially angiosperm cell wall, we can say that cell wall is mainly made up of a polysaccharide. That polysaccharide is called cellulose. Actually, cellulose is a polymer of glucose linked together by beta-1,4 linkage. That is the chemical structure of cellulose. It is a linear, unbranched glucose polymer connected by beta-1,4 linkage. That is about cell wall. And based on the origin of cell wall, we can categorize that cell wall into two. One is called primary cell wall. And second one is called secondary cell wall. In simple term, we can differentiate primary cell wall and secondary cell wall. That is, first formed cell wall is called primary cell wall, or a cell wall produced by a young plant cell is called primary cell wall. But during the growth of young plant cell, its protoplasm increases in size. Due to the increase in size of protoplasm, its cell membrane can able to expand because cell membrane shows high elastic property. But the cell wall around that cell membrane cannot able to expand because cell wall don't have elastic property. So due to the increase in the size of protoplasm, the primary cell wall get disrupted or replaced by a new cell wall, that is called a second formed cell wall, that is called a secondary cell wall. In most of the cases, secondary cell wall act as the permanent cell wall. and that secondary cell wall communicate, that secondary cell wall connect with the adjacent cell wall by using middle lamella or plasmodesmatic connection. So this is about secondary cell wall, whereas in rare cases primary cell wall act as the permanent cell wall without producing secondary cell wall. Next we move to protoplasm. Protoplasm means the whole plant pot except cell wall. That protoplasm can be categorized into two. One is called the nucleus, that acts as a controlling unit. And second one is called cytoplasm. Second, that is the fluid filled region. Fluid, the fluid which is present within the cell, cytoplasm. That cytoplasm contain various kind of cell organelles and ergastic substances, which we will discuss here later. Ergastic substances. So cytoplasm, protoplasm is divided into nucleus, cytoplasm then divided into cell organelles and ergastic substance. Let us try to study nucleus first. Nucleus is the controlling unit of a cell. When we try to study the structure of nucleus, you can see that nucleus contains an outer membrane and inner membrane. That outer membrane and inner membranes are connected or fused together at regular intervals, create a small opening there. That opening is called nuclear pore. That opening is called nuclear pore. Like that, you can see the nuclear pore at several regions. And within that, so you can say that outer membrane, it is an outer membrane. This is an inner membrane. This is a nuclear pore. In between the outer and inner membrane, you can see perinuclear space, the space in between outer and inner membrane. And inner to that nuclear membrane, you can see a fluid. That fluid is called the nucleoplasm. Fluid inside the nucleus is called the nucleoplasm. And you can also see a long thread-like network within the nucleus. That network is called chromatin reticulum, chromatin fiber, chromatin network. That chromatin fiber acts as a genetic material for DNA. Actually, it is a DNA. That chromatin network condenses with the help of histone and non-histone protein and forms a closely packed structure called the chromosome. That process happens only during the division of cell, especially within the prophase of cell cycle. And you can see a dark colored region within the genetic material, within the regions of genetic material, that is called the nucleolus. That nucleolus is the site of ribosomal RNA, that is rRNA synthesis site. Actually, that nucleolus is the overlapping region of whole chromatin fibers. This is the structure related, this is the broader structure regarding with the nucleus. And the main reason behind the controlling unit of this nucleus is the presence of a specific genetic material within this nucleus. Nucleus contains genetic material, that is DNA. That is why this nucleus is called controlling unit of the cell. That DNA can able to synthesize different kinds of RNA and different kinds of protein. Actually, that RNA synthesis or transcription takes place within the nucleus. But after the synthesis of RNA, especially messenger RNA, that messenger RNA move into the cytoplasm. Within that cytoplasm, that messenger RNA then translated into that messenger RNA then produces different kinds of protein. So actually, this DNA controls the whole cellular function by producing different kinds of protein, enzyme, hormone, etc. Okay, that is why it is called controlling unit of the cell. This is about the nucleus present within the cytoplasm. Next, let us try to study the cytoplasmic content. Cytoplasm contains mainly cell organelles and ergastic substance. Cell organelle include, one is called mitochondria. We know that mitochondria is called the powerhouse of the cell. because that mitochondria can able to synthesize cellular energy called ATP, adenosine triphosphate, through a special process called electron transport system and oxidative phosphorylation. That is why mitochondria is called powerhouse of the cell. That mitochondria also contain outer membrane, inner membrane, folding of inner membrane called cristae, and a fluid called matrix. Okay, like that you can see lot of ribosome within that matrix. You can see different kinds of enzyme within the inner membrane. That enzymes are responsible for the production of ATP. So if you try to explain all the details regarding with mitochondria, it will take lot of hours. So here we are going to describe only a broad structure of mitochondria. Okay, like that you can see chloroplast, you can see plastid, not chloroplast, you can see plastid. Actually, plastid is a cell organelle. Actually, plastid is a cell organelle. Plastid is a cell organelle. So, second one is mitochondria. Second one, plastid. Actually, plastid is a cell organelle found commonly or found only in plant cell and few lower organism. Like, for example, you can see plastid in algae, including plants, and few protists like euglenoid, dinoflagellate, etc. Plastid. And that plastid may be of different type. One is called chloroplast. Chloroplast is a plastid which contain high amount of chlorophyll pigment. So chloroplast is an example for plastid. But that plastid contain, chloroplast is a plastid contain high amount of chlorophyll pigments. That is why it is called chloroplast. So their main function is preparing food, that is photosynthesis. And that chloroplast contain outer membrane, inner membrane. In between outer membrane and inner membrane, you can see periplastidial space. And you can see double membrane, sac-like structure, double membrane, sac-like structure. The double membrane sac-like structure is called thylakoid. And you can see bundles of thylakoid. That bundles of thylakoid are collectively known as grana. And adjacent grana are interconnected by a connection. That connection is called stroma lamella. And over that thylakoid membrane, you can see chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, carotenes, endothelium. Among these pigments, chlorophyll A, the amount of chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B is higher when compared to chlorophyll carotene and endothelium. That is why chloroplast, that is why this plastid is called chloroplast. The definition of chloroplast is that it is a plastid which contains high amount of chlorophyll when compared to other photosynthetic pigment like carotene and xanthophyll. You know that carotene is a red or orange colored pigment. Xanthophyll is a yellow colored pigment. But compared to chlorophyll pigment, its amount is low. That is why it is called chloroplast. Like that you can see chromoplast. Chromoplast is a plastid which contains high amount of carotene and xanthophyll pigment when compared to chlorophyll. Here carotene and xanthophyll is high, chlorophyll is low. So the function of chloroplast is to carry out photosynthesis, that is preparing glucose. But the function of this chromoplast is to provide orange, red, yellow color to flowers and fruit. Thereby, it can able to attract the pollinating agents and can attract seed dispersal agent. And third one is called leucoplast. Leucoplast. Chloroplast, chromoplast, leucoplast is a colorless plastid. Pigments are completely absent. Their main function is to store food material in different form. One leucoplast stores food material in the form of a protein. Such leucoplasts are called alluroplasts. And some leucoplasts store food in the form of a starch. Such leucoplasts are called amyloplasts. Some store food in the form of an oil and fat. Such type of leucoplast is called ileoplast. So the function of leucoplast is to store food material in different form. and the 4,000 that equipments are totally absent. This is about plastid. So we here explain what is the broad structure of mitochondria and chloroplast. Like that, you can see endoplasmic reticulum, you can see Golgi bodies, you can see lysosome, you can see spherosome, and you can see ribosome. These are all the organelles found within the cytoplasm of plant cell. And when we take endoplasmic reticulum, the endoplasmic reticulums are usually originate from the nuclear membrane up to the cell membrane. They originate from the nuclear membrane up to the cell membrane. You can see like this. So endoplasmic reticulum is a network. It is a network of tubular structure extended from nuclear membrane to the cell membrane. In some ER, you can see the presence of ribosome. Then such type of ER are called rough ER. In some cases, the ribosomes are totally absent. Such type of ER are called smooth ER. Rough ER act as the site of protein synthesis. Smooth ER act as the site of lipid synthesis. And when we move into the Golgi bodies are usually found near to the ER because the function of Golgi bodies are connected with the function of ER. The main function of Golgi body is that packaging of material. Its function is packaging of material that has been delivered into the cell or out of the cell. Mainly, ER act as the site of production of protein, lipid, etc. All those protein, all those lipid produced within the ER then move into the Golgi bodies. Within that Golgi bodies, its modification, final modification and primary modification of those products which are produced within the ER are modified within the Golgi bodies and then made into small pack and then transport into the respective site. That is the function of Golgi bodies. Okay, then when we move into the lysosome is a simply, it is an enzyme filled bag. It is an enzyme filled bag containing different kinds of hydrolytic enzymes. That is, it contains protease, protein digesting enzyme, lipid digesting enzyme, carbohydrate digesting enzyme. That is called protease, lipase, and carbohydrates. And they act as a defensive mechanism of plant by distracting the foreign particle enter into the cell, and it also distracts the non-functional cell organelle within the cell through a special process. That process is called phagocytosis, that is engulfing or solid object. So it can able to distract the foreign particle which are entering into the cell and also distract the non-functional cell organelle which are not need for the plant. And this lysosome act as a suicide back of the cell because in some cases this lysosome destructs the functional cell, leads to a special type of mechanism that is called apoptosis or programmed cell death. In some cases, plant need to remove some part of plant. In some cases, plant need to remove some part. Due to the infection. So during that cases, lysosome destruct its cell, thereby it can able to eliminate the infectious part of the branch. And when we move into the spherosome simply it has lipid globule. It is a vesicle filled with lipid and a few enzymes like phosphatase, DNase, RNase for performing some kind of function within the cell, which we'll discuss later. Okay. And like that, you can see ribosome. Ribosome is a membraneless organelle. It is a membraneless organelle found within the eukaryotic cell, that is plant cell. That ribosome contains smaller subunit, larger subunit, which are connected by magnesium 2+. The main function of ribosome is that they are mainly help for protein synthesis within the cell. That is why we can see ribosome on the rough endoplasmic reticulum, which act as the site of protein synthesis. And that ribosome is made up of two components, mainly rRNA, ribosomal RNA and the protein. Okay. These are all the cell organelles related with the plant cell. And now we need to study one more thing about the plant cell, that is the cytoplasm contains cell organelle and ergastic substances. Ergastic substances is a non-living material produced by the live plant cell. And that ergastic substance may be categorized, that ergastic substance is classified into three categories. One is called reserved material. For example, live plant cell synthesize glucose molecule through photosynthesis. That glucose molecule stored in the form of a starch for future as an energy source. So that starch is a non-living material produced by the live plant cell. It is a reserve food. It's a source of energy, reserve food for future. Like that, you can see secretory product. Plant produces different kinds of secretory product. I'll give an example. One example is called nectar. Nectar is a secretory product produced by the nectar gland of flower to attract the pollinating agent. Or that nectar acts as a reward for pollinating agent. So it's a secretory product. Like that, you can see a lot of pigments. Chlorophyll B, carotene, sandophyll, these are all the secretory products. And like that, that compound also non-living. And third one is called excretory product. Excretory product. We know that plants lack a well-developed excretory system like human's kidney. So in case of plant, their excretory product will store within the within a specified cell. After the removal of that, after the death of that specified cell, or after the removal of that specified cell or part from plant, the excretion process will occur. That is the basic excretion principle occurs in plant cell. So plant produces various kind of excretory product as a byproduct of various metabolic reaction takes place within the cell. So these are the three categories of ergastic substances. So here the topic ergastic substances is somewhat broad, somewhat large. We have to study separately about these ergastic substances, which we'll study during the next video class. Now let us stop here. We'll start this topic during next video class. Okay.